next one is Give Thanks, and it is 2036. Is Awesome God, page 2040.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is a good morning, and it's good that we are all here together in this time at this place. I invite you to take a moment to look at your bulletin and the announcements that are there. In particular, we draw your attention to your inserts. It's time, if you're going to order a poinsettia, to be thinking about that. You have this Sunday, next Sunday, and December 2nd is the last chance for that. So take time to read through that. Respond as it's appropriate for you. Would also draw your attention to the other insert, which has given us information about our Christmas dinner for this year. Take a chance to look through that and decide what it is that you're being led to respond to and participate with that time together. If you haven't already done so, I invite you to take a moment to sign the friendship pads along the edge of the aisle, and then be sure to pass it all the way down to the end so everybody has a chance to sign, and then end folk, pass it back so the other folk have a chance to know who it is they're sharing the pew with. If you are a first-time guest with us, we invite you to take one of the welcome bags at the back or from the table at the Welcome Center by the main entrance with that. As you saw on the slides, Micah is still having need during this time of year for supplies for their shelves with that. If you're feeling a nudge to help with that response to the needs of the community, this would be a great time to respond to that. Our UMYF youth are selling some really cool travel mugs. If you want to enjoy your coffee, have it stay hot, and look cool while you do it, you have a chance to be able to purchase a mug from them. But wait, that is not all. If you respond yet today, you could have a chance to pick one up in the liturgical color for the season of Advent. So you can not only look cool, you can be seasonally correct as well. So if you're interested, grab a hold of one of our youth and help them out with their proceeds for that for the trip. Would also would like to continue to thank you for the name tags. As you look out, it's good to see those out there. It's helpful for me. It's also helpful for anybody who decides to visit the other service to be able to continue to connect names and faces, as well as any guests we have among us. It gives them a chance to be able to address us as well. We'd also invite that you mark the 29th, the 6th, and the 13th, and the 20th on your calendars. Those Sunday evenings, we'll be having our Advent study. There's some information in the bulletin for you to look at that you can be a part of that. Also remind you, on December 4th is going to be the No Room at the End. That's going to be held over at St. Mary's. As we are one of the participants for that, if you have a nativity set or an angel you would like to share for that time, there's information for you here. Be sure to gather those up and get them here at the church. We do want to say thanks to Carol Jordan, who is sharing with us this morning our altar flowers in memory of Jack Allgood. We want to say thanks, Carol, for your generosity in sharing that as we honor that memory. Do we have any other additions or corrections that we need to be aware of this morning? I know we got one. Where you at? There we go.
Thank you, everybody who took part in the prayer vigil yesterday. And I hope that just keep that list around and refer to that as you have your daily prayer time. Also, I would add with this No Room at the Inn, if you'd bring your nativity set next Sunday, you can put it in the outer office, and then the following Sunday, pick it up from there. If you have a nativity set, but you don't feel you're quite up to bringing it here, give me a call or call the church, and we'll come get it. It's really a nice event to see all those nativities, and that will be the same as Jingle Bell Holiday. They have live music during the dinner hour, and it's great. So we hope you get a lot of people participating in that.
Okay. Thank you. Terry.
I just wanted to thank all the bakers and all the purchasers. Mass Class raised a little over $600 last Sunday that has been given to the church budget. It wouldn't have been possible without all of you. So thank you.
You bet. Thank you. Are there any? Yes, Jill.
Carla Kelling announced at the first service that the Christmas share envelopes and are already in the Fellowship Center, and she couldn't be here for this service, but her and Sally Smith will be back after this service. So if you could stop and pick up any of the Christmas share envelopes to help out. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Are there any others?
I have a foundation minute. About 50 years ago, a church family by the name of Coots gave 10 shares of stock in the United States Steel Corporation. Those 10 shares turned out to be a couple $1,000s, and they said use the profits from that to buy Bibles. Well, since we've really been keeping a close track since the year 2009, that fund has purchased Bibles for all of our kids at the appropriate time. Plus, right now, we have $3,152 in that account. So, what has your family done for the foundation?
Okay, any others? Then I invite you to stand as you're able, that you can share with each other your signs of love and reconciliation.
Good morning. Last summer, when it was a lot warmer, Pastor Dave preached on several ways that Jesus' message to us is counterintuitive or unexpected. A big part of that difference arises because of the distinction between standards of the world, or ways of the world, and standards or ways of God. Pastor Dave summarized that difference as one between efficiency versus effectiveness. So often, what makes sense to us as an efficient course of action actually misses the big picture of what will be effective in ushering in God's kingdom. Our scripture for today falls in that same category because it contrasts the standards of the world with the standards of God. The situation arises when Jesus appears before Pilate, the Roman governor. Pilate asks Jesus whether he is a king, and Jesus tells him that his kingdom is not of this world. He goes on to say that by standards of this world, his followers would rely on violence to defend him. Yet Jesus does not call up an army to defend him, and he allows himself to be crucified. That's a complicated message for us in the days following senseless violence in Paris or Beirut, as our leaders and we determine the appropriate response. Can we annihilate ISIS, the stated goal of President Hollande of France? In cleaning up and downsizing around our house, ever-ending job I have discovered, I've been sorting through papers from an earlier era, from the 1960s, when many similar issues were debated. I don't want to relive the contentiousness of that period, which was so dominated by the Vietnam War, but that certainly was a time of questioning over what we would accomplish through escalating violence. You may recall that there were statements of that period, such as, "We had to destroy the village in order to save it." Over the past 10 years, in our travels to visit family in Vietnam, I found it particularly interesting to see how the Vietnamese tell their story of that same period, whether in the military museums of Hanoi that acknowledge the U.S. advantage in terms of firepower, or crawling through the Cu Chi tunnels to understand the way the Viet Cong could mobilize so effectively in the South in spite of the large U.S. presence there. Currently, we ponder how much personal freedom and privacy we're willing to give up on the grounds of national security. But we also might ponder how much violence we're willing to accept or inflict on others in order to efficiently reach the goal of an earthly kingdom or effectively bring a heavenly kingdom closer. Any answers, I think, will become quite complicated. Please join me in an attitude of prayer. Gracious God, we're thankful for the many blessings of living in Grinnell, and we lift up those families mourning the loss of loved ones at the hands of violence elsewhere in the world. Help us comprehend your ways and the type of kingdom that Jesus offers us. May we recognize how we can be effective in living our lives in a way that moves us toward that vision. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jack. Will you stand if you're able and join me in the call to worship? Come, let us bow down and worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. This birth, the angels proclaimed it. He is the wonderful counselor, Lord of Lords, King of Kings, the Prince of Peace. Through his teaching and his life, we have learned how to live to God. By his death and resurrection, we have been saved and claimed by God as witnesses to God's eternal love. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, Majesty, Worship His Majesty, number 176 in the hymnal. Thank you. You may be seated. Will you please join me in the opening prayer? With thankful hearts, we pause this day to be reminded of our grandest hope, that the calamities, the demands, even the blessings of this world do not have the last word. You are the one who was and who is yet to come, a ruler of a different kind. Open our hearts to the comfort, the challenge, and the mystery of this good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, your faithful witness, we pray. Amen. And now the praise team will present the song, How Great You Are. We would love it if you would sing along with us. It's number 3015 in the green worship and song book.
Thank you.
Today's scripture reading is from the Gospel book of John, the 18th chapter, verses 33 through 37. We'll hear how Jesus answered the charge when some called him King of the Jews with, "My kingdom is not from this world." If you are able, could you please stand for the reading of the Gospel? Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, and he summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" And Pilate replied, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." And Pilate asked him, "So, you are a king?" And Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Now at this time, you may be seated. At this time, we invite the children to come forward for children's time with Pastor Dave.
Doing good? Are you just doing good or doing really good? Then it needs to sound like it in your voice. Because if you're really doing good, your eyes are going to show it, your face is going to show it, and your voice is going to sound it. So how you doing?
Really good.
Okay, we're making progress. We're making progress. How many of you went out and played in the snow? Yeah? Yeah, sort of, sort of. Any of you make snowmen? Oh, it was good wet snow. It was packed up beautifully when it first came down. Then it got cold. Yeah. Did you make anything with the snow?
No.
Footprints. There you go. Okay. Well, if you're going to make a snowman, you know what you have to do, right? You got to roll the snow. You got to make all the parts. And they got to put all the parts together. And when you get all the parts together just right, what do you got? You got a snowman, yeah.
So, you have to have a carrot for
it. Well, that's one of the parts, isn't it? To have a carrot for the nose, something for the eyes, maybe a scarf. You wouldn't want the snowman getting cold, would you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you get it too hot, it was cold.
He'd be happier if it was cold. Well, if we were going to make something today, would you be willing to do that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. I need a volunteer. Okay, Charlie. Okay, Charlie. Charlie, come up here with me. Because what we're going to do today with Charlie, since this is Christ the King Sunday, you know what we're going to do with Charlie? We're going to make Charlie a king.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what do we have to do? What do we have to do to make Charlie a king?
Put a crown on his head.
Put a crown on his head. We can do that because it just so happens. I got a crown.
I'm not. This is a queen's crown.
No. That's a king's crown. So, Charlie's king now, right?
Yes.
Is he king?
Queen.
King?
King.
What else does Charlie need if he's really going to be king?
Fancy clothes.
Fancy clothes? That would help. That would help. I haven't got any fancy clothes. What else would a king need? A what?
A sword.
A sword? Yeah, but he had to check that at the door when he came in. What else would a king need? Maybe a throne. Big chair right up there. Okay, so we've got a crown. His sword's been checked at the door. He's got a big throne chair. So now Charlie is king, right? No? No? You don't have a king in a town? Well, some towns do. Some towns might, some parts of the world. But you know, the crown, the cape, the fancy clothes, a sword, a scepter, even a throne, it's not enough to make someone a king. Pilate wanted to know what it took to make Jesus a king. And he kept asking, and Jesus kept trying to explain to him, because what Jesus told Pilate is that if you truly want to be a king, it starts with your heart. And if your heart is right with God, that's all the royalty you need to really be important in this world. And the good news is that God loves each of us so much, it is God's love that makes us important in this world. Not a crown. Not a crown, no matter how much we like it. Not even a big chair, no matter how much we like that. Not even fancy clothes or a big house or even a sword. What makes us really important is God's love. Would you pray with me? In fact, why don't you reach out and hook a hand with the person next to you? Everybody hook a hand. Here we go. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you for loving us so much. You chose to make us important to you. And because of that, we've got love to share with the people around us, which then makes them important as well. We thank you for this. Amen. Thanks for your help, Charlie.
Stay right here.
So, for the rest of you, what is it that makes a king a king? Is it that they're the head of a state, that they are a ruler? Is it because they came to power by either succession or selection or by conquest? You know, when they come to power as that king or queen or prince or princess, they could either be an actual sovereign or they could just be a political figurehead. But either way, they're raised up above the rest. Pilate wanted to know whether this Jesus who was before him, whether somehow this Jesus had been raised to that level of king. Was he really who the people said he was? Now, in that conversation that Monique read for us, if you listen close, Jesus neither confirms nor denies what it is that people are saying about him. Instead, he replies to Pilate's question with his own. He wants to know what Pilate thinks. Pilate needed to know, though, was this man king or not? Jesus wouldn't say. And so those two kind of began this verbal chess match back and forth. Pilate asks, Jesus wouldn't answer. Jesus asks, Pilate wouldn't answer. Pilate asks, and so back and forth they went. In the game of chess, the goal is to capture the other king, or to be more accurate, actually, to create a checkmate where you trap the king in such a way that he can no longer make a move. In chess, no one really gets to actually capture the king. The knights, the rooks, the bishops, even the pawns are there to set the trap so the king can no longer move. Kings, you see, have a certain prerogative. By virtue of their high rank, one of them, a king, is never really allowed to surrender to anyone who is not their equal. Pilate had heard the claim that Jesus was king, king of the Jews. And if he really was king, then Pilate couldn't accept the surrender. That'd have to happen at Rome. But here he stood. He didn't have the hat. He didn't have the big chair. He didn't have the royal clothes. Just the claim. Was he really a king? Pilate was only the procurator, a middle manager, procurator. He was just the middle manager in a Roman imperial system. He had to know whether this was king or not, or he would have to pass it on to somebody else. Would he send this person to Rome bound in chains as a captured king, or if he was what he looked to be, Pilate could simply handle it and dispose of him himself. So Pilate wanted to know, are you king or not? How you answer whether Jesus is king or not would depend on how you understand what makes a king a king. If it is the social political position, then no, Jesus was not a king. He was a carpenter by trade, came from a non-aristocratic family. He was a commoner, no royalty there. If Jesus was to be king because he had been selected through a recognized process from a family or cohort who was eligible to be a sovereign head of state, it'd still be no. Jesus did not come from that line or from that situation in life. Would Jesus be king because he acclaimed himself to be by virtue of conquest? Well, no. Though this one might actually be the closest of them so far, if you include the conquest of sin and death into the conversation. But that's a post-resurrection conversation. This conversation was happening even before the crucifixion. Is Jesus king because the people are declaring him to be their king? Does he accept that elevation in office? What is it that makes Jesus king? Jesus actually gives an answer to the question of what makes a true king. It's one who rules, who lives for the sake of those whose lives they are responsible for. It's not about politics. It's not about entitlements of rank. It's not even about being served by those who are under you. Leadership, he teaches, is all about being the servant. Jesus' leadership does not follow all the rules of the world that define power and privilege. He is not defined by what others think about him, what he should be, what they think he is. Instead, he follows rules of grace, love, and mercy. Those, he teaches, are the rules of leadership. Those, he teaches, are the rules that a true king, a true queen, a true prince or princess would be following. He lays that out in all of his teaching, in his telling of the parables, whether it's the story about the Good Samaritan or the fruitful fig tree or even the faithful stewards. He lays out the examples of what it means to give yourself for the sake of the other. You see it in his own ministry, where he healed when the need of the other required it, where he fed when the hunger of the other required it, where he included people because the loneliness of their lives required it. He forgave when the brokenness of their lives required it. He even gave life when death required it. For all of that, the people turned to him for direction through the chaos of their lives, for hope in the midst of their despair, for strength in the midst of their powerlessness, for validation in the midst of their oppression, subjection, and when the world just ignored their being. He cared for them as no sovereign would, but only as a king could. He did explain to Pilate that his purpose was not to claim power in this world, at least not in Rome's sense of the word. He was there to give witness to the power of the truth of God's love and of God's sovereignty. And when Pilate heard that, his response was, "Truth? What in the world is that? Where is the power of truth in this world that is controlled by information, commerce, and the sword?" It's really no wonder that Pilate just snorted at this. He, of all people, understood the realities of his world. Truth was what power defined it to be. You can read the news today through whatever lens you want, and Pilate's question of what is truth is as germane today as it was when he first asked it. Where is the power of truth in a world that is still controlled by information, by commerce, and by military might? Aren't those the things that really do shape our understanding of life, our hopes, and even our fears? Aren't those the things, when it comes right down to it, that actually shape our choices, our actions, and our inactions. Jesus was making clear that it's not our understanding of what makes a king or a leader a king or a leader that directs our lives. It's our understanding of what is true that shapes who we are. Next slide, please. There are a lot of things that want to define who we are. Any number or combination of all of these things will try to determine who you are. Some of them are external, some of them are internal to ourselves. What is it that you actually accept as true about who you are? Because what you accept as true will be what gives, what your life gives witness to. If in the midst of all of this you come to believe that you are more important or someone is less important than you are, you will treat them as such, and you will find yourself being elevated at their expense. Our security and our comfort begins to displace their needs as the focus of our concerns. The ease of our fears takes precedent over the easing of their pain and their suffering. And our need to be happy will blind us to all the sorrows of this world. What defines who you are, who we are? Many of these things and what they have to say about us aren't really true. Christ gives us a truth that far exceeds any of these. You, we, all of humanity are the beloved of God. It does not matter on your country of origin, on your age, on your gender, or your orientation. It doesn't matter which political party you belong to or what political system you support. It doesn't matter what your vocation is. It does not matter what your life choices have been. You, the person next to you, the stranger on the street, the nameless one from half a world away, are God's beloved. That is the truth that defines us and the truth that Christ gives witness to. Accept that and let that be what shapes who you are. Between services, I had someone come up and share with me that after they heard what I had shared thus far, that they had come across a story on the internet. It was the testimony of a young father whose wife had been killed in the attacks in Paris, leaving behind himself and their small child. This father went on public record testifying that he would not allow those terrorists to take his love away. He would not allow hate to replace the love. He wasn't seeking vengeance. He wasn't seeking retribution. And he went on public record for the world to say, "And I will teach my son how to love as well." What is it that defines you? If we truly accept Christ as our King and the kingdom that he brings to us, we will be seeking for those ways to allow that love of God to define us, and in defining us, shape the life we live as we interact with one another. It is on this Sunday that as a church, as Christendom, we celebrate the fact we have a King who lays claim to our lives so deeply it changes and defines who we are. It is in the name of that King that today we have gathered. I invite you to stand as you're able, that we can join together in hymn number 166, "All Praise to Thee, O King Divine." As we gather together this day, as God's people, as God's beloved, we are mindful that we come with all the joys and the cares that have made up our week. As we gather together here this day, are there requests for prayer, joys or concerns? Terry.
I had a good visit with the pulmonologist and got encouraging news, which was nice. But also, I just wanted to thank the congregation for all of their support that they've been giving Don and I. We've gotten lots of prayers, cards, meals. I don't think Don's had to cook for a week and a half, which is probably good. But you're a great congregation, and we really appreciate all of the care and concern and love you've been showing us.
Okay. So we're going to give thanks for the good news from the doctor, and thanks for the support of the congregation. Thanks, Terry. Are there others? Yes, Shane.
Yeah, my cousin Jennifer, her son passed away. It was killed in a car wreck this past week. And just, he was just graduated high school. Mm. So kind of pray for their strength to get them through the times coming.
Okay. For your cousin Jennifer and their loss of their son, the car crash. Okay, thank you, Shane. Are there others? Yes.
Just the joy that we have a couple of members of our congregation who participated in the All-State Choir last night at Iowa State University, Jonah Bedingshorb and David Gilbert. And Zach Lofton, who's not in our congregation.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. We'll give our thanks for those in the Allstate, the gifts that they brought to that, and we'll celebrate the joy of it. Thank you. Are there others? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we do give our thanks to you for the many ways in which you have blessed our lives, in which you have claimed us as your own, and you have let your love flow into our living and through it. Lord, we give our thanks in our celebration as we celebrate with Rob Yellick the news that he has successfully completed his classwork, and he's now on his way to the next steps of becoming a certified lay servant. We also give our thanks for the successful completion of her doctorate degree for Abby Koperman Pettig. We are grateful for the many ways in which you offer to us your gifts of healing, and we celebrate with Terry the good news she's received from her doctor, but also for the love and support she's received from this congregation. We give our thanks as Karen Packard shared with us her healing and progress from her surgeries. We thank you for that. And Lord, we thank you for the way in which you have gifted and blessed each of our lives, that we can offer ourselves to this world in such ways that we bless it ourselves, and we give our thanks for the gifts of all of those folk who have been a part of the Allstate Choir. Thank you for gifting them as such. Lord, we pray for those who are dealing with the parts of life that are more difficult. We pray that they might find the healing that they need, the comforts that they need. We lift in our prayers this morning Margaret Nicewilder and Burrow Beck, Tim Turba with his deployment, Sandy Evans as she goes through her healing, which is going more slowly than what she had hoped for. We pray for Shane's cousin Jennifer, the death of their son. Shane's cousin Jennifer and the death of their son in the car crash. We pray for Shannon with his upcoming foot surgery, as well as for the mending of his broken finger. Lord, we pray for those whose lives are torn by violence, that they might find in the midst of that pain your peace. And we lift up those who are dealing with mental health concerns, whether it's their own or that of another. Lord, we are grateful for those who have responded to your call and offer themselves in the ministry of sharing the witness and the depth of your love. We give our thanks for those in the Stephen ministry and for the work of the Trinity United Methodist Church and for the congregations of the Women at the Well, both inside the walls and outside. Lord, we also lift up those who are dealing with long-term needs. We hold up Dennis and Darlene and Peyton and Barb and Hunter. And we pray they might each find the strength, the endurance, the comfort that they require. And Lord, we also give our thanks. We received word last hour that Carla Cornish's foot surgery went well and she is making good progress as well. We thank you for that healing. Lord, for all of these things which we hold upon our hearts, we pray as your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, there is the problem when you write fast and you have poor penmanship. Sometimes you can't read your own notes. We do have a prayer of thanksgiving as well for all the ways in which the congregation has reached out for Jerry's daughter and offering their love and support with that as well. As the ushers wait upon us, this is an opportunity for us to offer, and also a privilege for us to be able to offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Let us pray. Abundant God, prophecy says you are coming with the clouds for every eye to see. Until that day, may the tithes and offerings we bring each week do the holy work of making your reign real in this community and in this world in need. Amen. You may be seated. Shannon, would you come forward? It is through the sacrament of baptism that we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. It is through our reaffirmation of our faith that we renew the covenant declared at our baptism and acknowledge what God is doing for us and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church. Shannon has come before us this morning in order to make that reaffirmation of his baptismal covenant. Shannon, therefore, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Put your whole trust in his grace and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to peoples of all ages, nations, and races.
I do.
According to the grace given to you, will you remain a faithful member of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representative in the world?
I will.
Let us all join together. Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under
Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of God.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all people. Pour out your Holy Spirit, and by this gift of water, call to our remembrance the grace declared to us in our baptism. For you have washed away our sins, and you clothe us with righteousness through our lives, that dying and rising with Christ, we may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Shannon, may you remember your baptism and be thankful for it. Let me touch the water if you like. And now, Shannon, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let us rejoice in the thankfulness of our covenant with God. We give thanks for all that God has already given us as members of the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We will faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you, Shannon, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. Thank you. As we remember our baptismal covenant as well, and all the joy and grace that brings to us, we are also reminded that we are sent in Christ's name as well. I invite you to stand that we can join in our closing hymn, Sent Out in Jesus' Name. Now, as we prepare ourselves to go from this time and place, to follow the light of Christ from this room out into the world, may you go knowing that it is God's love that has wrapped itself around you so tightly that you cannot escape it. That it is God's love that holds you so firmly you cannot help but give testimony to it. You go from this place sent in Jesus' name with that same Christ choosing to walk with you on that venture. You go sent forth in Christ's name from this room with God's own Spirit filling you, empowering you, sustaining you. You are sent in Christ's name.